Morning, everyone. I'm going to pray as we come to God's word. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for a new day. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the great privilege we have of looking at it together now. And we pray that as the gospel takes root in our lives, it might well up and bear fruit in love. And we pray, Father, that you might grow in us a sincere love for our brothers and sisters in Christ. But Father, we need help with this. And so we pray for your spirit to be at work now in our hearts, that as we look together at your word, we would be changed and shaped more and more into the likeness of Jesus Christ, and that that would be reflected in our relationships with one another. In his name we pray. Amen. Well, I'm going to read from 1 Peter 1 and verse 22. We're picking up from where we left off yesterday. And Peter writes this: "Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for your brothers, love one another deeply from the heart." Peter's talking here about what should characterize our relationships in church family. And he's saying that if you've professed faith in Christ, if you've accepted and believed the gospel, if you're living with Jesus Christ as your Lord, well, then your life should be marked by sincere brotherly love. That's what he says here in verse 22. As the gospel takes root in our lives, that's what it should produce. Now, of course, sincere love is love that is without hypocrisy. It's love that is genuine. It's not two-faced. Now, why do I say all those things? Well, look further down at chapter 2 and verse 1. And Peter says, look, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy and slander of every kind. Because those things have no place in a gospel community. And now, of course, Jesus himself in John chapter 13, you might just turn there with me in your Bibles, John 13 and verses 34 and 35, Jesus himself talked about this, where he said to his disciples, "A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." In his book, At the Mark of a Christian, Francis Schaeffer argued that such love should characterise all Christians. Indeed, Schaeffer argues that really Jesus, in that statement in John 13, is giving the world permission to judge the genuineness of our faith on the basis of the sincerity of our love for one another. And I think that's fair enough. If the unbelieving world looks in at the church and sees malice and deceit and hypocrisy and envy and slander, well, then it would have every right to wonder if we really are Christians. Or worse, it would have every right to wonder if Jesus really is real and if the church is really worth bothering with. Now, does that mean that where we come across that kind of conduct in church life, that we have permission to walk away either from church to find another one, or worse still, from the Christian life? Well, the answer to that is no. Peter will go on later in his letter to say, look, the glory of God is displayed in church life when Christian believers learn how to forgive one another, when they learn how to say sorry where there's been sin, where they learn how to show grace and mercy and forgiveness when they've been sinned against. And a watching world looks in and sees something that is a really powerful apologetic for the truth of the gospel. It adds up, doesn't it, that the way in which the world tends to deal with sin and wrongdoing and conflict and hurt and pain is so often a way that it lacks grace. But when the world looks in into the church and sees that we love one another sincerely and we love one another deeply, so deep that we're actually able to say, I forgive you. So deeply that we're actually able to sit down and say, let's work this out in grace. That becomes a very powerful demonstration of the truth of the gospel, which is that God in his love for us sent Christ to offer forgiveness and salvation to sinners like us. And when sinners like us offer that forgiveness to one another, the gospel is lived out in 3D. It's so powerful in church life. Not that that means, of course, that it's easy. So we've got to think this morning, how do we express this kind of love? Sincere, deep, brotherly love. Well, I guess a really important thing to say at this point is we mustn't confuse this call to love one another deeply from the heart with feelings and emotions. It's not to say those things don't matter, but they're not always the same. And of course, in the Western world, so often we hear the word love and we tend to think immediately in terms of either erotic love or sentimental love. And we get caught up with love as defined by our feelings and our emotions in the moment. And the truth is, when we go down that road, it's rarely helpful. It's a recipe for disappointment, because feelings and emotions come and go. And it's a recipe for confusion, because we can't always, as sinful people, we can't always trust what our feelings may tell us in the moment. So we need to remember here these words of Peter in verse 22. He talks about sincere love, and he talks about loving one another deeply from the heart. So much of love in our culture is neither sincere nor deep. But God's love for us in Christ is sincere and it is deep. And therefore we need to think of love in terms of the whole person, not just the body or the emotions or the biology of it, but actually the whole person, the mind, the will, the affections. And of course we need to look to the love that God has shown us in Christ, because that is the ultimate model for us to follow, expressed of course most wonderfully at the cross. The kind of love we see at the cross is a love expressed in blood, sweat, tears, a love expressed in agony and sacrifice and great cost and great suffering. It's gritty, and yet it's glorious, because it was unconditional love poured out through the grace and the mercy of God, a love that we didn't deserve. Now just imagine what happens in a church family when the more we look at Jesus Christ and what he did for us on the cross, and the more we allow his gospel to take root in our lives, and the more we live with him as Lord and as our ultimate authority, imagine what that then produces in us. Well, by the power of the Holy Spirit, it will produce in us the kind of love that we actually see at the cross. And so we find it in us to forgive one another, to love one another, to care for one another at great cost. Forgiving one another is costly. Turning up to a growth group on a Wednesday evening or whatever it might be, that's costly. You could be doing something else. Being at Prayer Central, that's costly. You could be doing something else. Turning up on a Sunday to love somebody who may not be very lovable, to sit next to somebody you've never met before, that's costly. But when the gospel takes root in our lives, it becomes possible. So here's the question for us to think about this morning. How can we express this kind of love, sincere brotherly love in which we love one another deeply from the heart? How can we do that? How can we live that out today? If you can, have a conversation with someone today about how you can do that. And then pray, because we need God's help. And I'm going to do that now. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word to us this morning. We thank you for calling us to a life in which we show sincere love for our brothers and our sisters, a life in which we love one another deeply from the heart, and we long that that would be in evidence in our church family here at St. James. But we don't always find this easy. We know we need your help, and we ask therefore that by your Spirit the gospel would take root in our lives. And we pray that as we live with Jesus Christ as our Lord, we would indeed be able to love one another deeply from the heart. In Jesus' name, amen.